Hello, hello, Mordimers here, and welcome to another semi-final day of Lindores Abbey Rapid Challenge 2020. And today I would like to show you the game, decisive game of the second match of the semi-final between Magnus Carlsen, world champion whose Rapid ranking is 2881, and he's gonna play as black, and Hikaru Nakamura, his opponent, who lost in the first mini-match against Magnus Carlsen 3-0. So if he wanted to stay, you know, in the tournament and played the third match, he had to win this match. So his Rapid ranking 2829, and he's gonna play as white. So without further ado, let's see what happened on the board. Hikaru Nakamura open with e4. We have e5, knight on f3, knight on c6, and bishop on b5. So Rui Lopez on the board, and Magnus Carlsen, as always, goes for a Berlin defense, knight on f6. And now, I told you just yesterday that the castle and knight on e4 is the main line here, and if you are interested how it goes, you can check the video I just showed it yesterday, because Hikaru Nakamura play against Magnus Carlsen the same opening, but Hikaru Nakamura prefers d3, more solid approach. And now bishop c5, controlling d4, and now preparing the knight to jump on d4 and attack the bishop. So there are two ways to prevent that. C3 is the one way, or exchanging this bishop for the knight. This is the way which Hikaru Nakamura prefers, and he plays that. We have d takes on c6, and now castle. Bishop on g4 by Magnus Carlsen, one of the rare lines, which is very, very exciting, and you will see why. We have h3, bishop on h5, and now g4. We don't see often that, but on the top level, but definitely this is very interesting. Magnus Carlsen goes for sacrificing the knight for the two pawns. So we have knight takes on g4, h takes on g4, bishop takes on g4, and now bishop e3. And this position was reached a couple of times. Most of the games were drawn, and the most famous game was by Peter Leko, who played as white against David Navarra in 2018. And in these games, all of these games we have in the database, bishop on d6 looked like the most, you know, natural and logical approach. It's defending e5, and so on. So what can go wrong? So for example, king on h1 is the main idea here, and also black playing f5, threatening some move like f4. So we have rook on g1, now attacking the bishop, so h5 first, and now e takes on f5. So this was played by Peter Leko, and after queen on f6, just develop the knight, very important, to d2. Okay, now the knight supports this knight and the queen can go. And after queen on f5, as I said, that was a draw. However, in this position, after bishop on e3, Magnus Carlsen had definitely some home preparation and play bishop on e7. The idea is to leave the d file a semi-open, which I will show you what would happen. So after king on h1, what was played by Hikaru Nakamura, f5, rook on g1, you see already that all of this makes sense. Just for your information, e takes on f5 would be very terrible blunder. Maybe you don't see that, maybe you see that, but look at this. e4, and this is deadly, winning the knight, because knight is pinned, and if d takes on e4, then losing the rook, because after exchanging, black gonna, you know, fork the rook and the king, and of course win the game. So this position is, you know, very, very poisonous, and white have to be very, very careful here. So rook on g1 was played like before, and now h5 defending. So definitely f4 is coming, and e takes on f5 still cannot be played. So what Hikaru Nakamura played here? Knight on c3. It's completely against any principles in this opening, because look at this knight. This knight cannot jump anywhere. Even here cannot jump because the knight is hanging on f3, so maybe with the support of king on g2. The only way maybe if the pawn is taken, but this pawn is going for f4. So here is the problem. And Hikaru didn't go for knight on d2 because of course f4 winning the bishop, as bishop would be blocked. But what he should play is king on g2 first, and after f4 just remaneuver the pieces, let's say g5, bishop on c3 now, attacking this pawn, and then knight b on d2. This is natural spot for this knight, okay? So this what should be played. However, Hikaru goes for knight on c3, and Magnus spent quite a lot of time, you know, how to punish Hikaru for such a move. So he played f4, we have bishop on d2, and now g5. So all the plan is the same, and here Hikaru thought for a while, and he understand that this knight, it doesn't belong to c3, and he played knight on b1, so he retreat. And here Magnus could go straight away for bishop on f3, and after queen on f3, queen d7, bishop c3, defend the pawn here on e5, and then with the plan with the you know, castle on the queen side, and then bring the rook to g file and attack with the support of this rook. So this would be a pretty safe plan for Magnus Carlsen. His king would be in the safety. However, he wanted to you know, punish Hikaru for the lack of development, and he played bishop on c5, attacking the pawn on f2, but keep in mind that this pawn on e5 gonna be vulnerable now. So we have bishop on c3 by Hikaru Nakamura, making a space for the knight, as it's more important to develop the pieces than, you know, take care of the one pawn here, or even the exchange. We have bishop on f2 and knight b on d2 now. So Hikaru doesn't care about the exchange, because supporting the knight is more important in releasing the queen from the pin, because this pin is a very, very annoying pin. We have queen on e7, now defending e5. However, as you see, it's attacked twice. For now, it doesn't really matter because the knight is pinned. But after queen on f1, now is an issue. So we have bishop on g1. Peter Lecco actually in studio said that maybe it would be good to save this bishop, but there is no really good squares for the bishop. It could go somewhere, you know, to c5 or b6 and support the game from there, but unlikely. The engine suggests bishop on g1. So bishop on g1 was played by Magnus Carlsen. Queen on g1, and here is the problem, because black cannot actually castle to bring the last rook to the game, because after castle we would have queen on a7, okay? And you see already that this can be very dangerous. The knight can jump to e5, control d7, and checkmate is coming. So for example, after taking exchanging on f3, king d7, queen on b7, and there is a lot of ideas for white definitely is winning this one. The knight gonna take on e5, the bishop gonna be on this diagonal with the rook, the knight also gonna attack c6 together with the queen. A lot of ideas, and difficult to, you know, defend against all of them. So that would be just disaster if Magnus castle here. So we have bishop takes on f3, knight takes on f3, and now g4, pushing the pawn, and knight takes on e5. So as you see, this pawn had to fall. So Magnus literally just exchanged this central pawn for the pawn on f2. What he achieved is three connected passed pawns attacking the king's position, and there are no pawns in front of the king. So who's gonna be better in this encounter? Very, very interesting. We have rook on g8 now, supporting g pawn, and rook on f1. Very smart idea, because now f3 would lose the pawn. Actually, it's not the worst move, because after f3, knight f3, rook f3 would actually lose the game after queen on h4, but knight on f3, And black actually could castle because now the knight is hanging. So queen a7 would actually lose the game after g takes on f3. And look at this, the position of the king is just bad, you know. There are a lot of ideas, mating ideas here. So definitely not this way. However, the knight could jump to e5 to control d7. And now this is a serious threat, which can be, of course, defended. Or maybe better idea is jump this knight from f3 just through d4 to f5. And f5, this is a perfect outpost for the knight, controlling also these squares. So white wouldn't have a problems to stop the advancing of this passed pawn. So this could be the idea of playing in this position. Queen on h4, not really great, because exchanging the queens are totally okay for white, as after f3, yes, black saved the pawn. The problem is after king g3, it's difficult to advance. White gonna, you know, get one more piece just to stop the advancing. For example, put it on h4. It can be rook, it can be maybe bishop, maybe knight. Just have to check the position, and other pieces can be just, you know, used for creating some threats and possibilities to win. So definitely good position for white if exchanging as well. So Magnus didn't go for that, and didn't go for f3, of course, and play queen on g5, which is actually the best move in the position. The problem is white can counterattack and play queen on d4. So now there is a very, very serious threat. First, black cannot castle, and also there is a check mating idea on f7. So black has to do something, and Magnus Carlsen has about 1 minute on the clock, and he has to act very, very fast. So he deliver a couple of checks to get the time first. So we have queen on h4, king on g1, queen on g3, king on h1, king on h3, king on g1, and here Magnus could go for a draw. However, he was fired up that he has a better position and he should win that. Actually, he could try, but the only move in the position is rook on d8, attacking the queen. And now if queen retreat, then after f3, black has everything under control and everything is fine, and white have to play. Exchanging the queens doesn't work really well in white's favor anymore, because black pawns are advanced too much now. And if queen on d2, this doesn't also look really great, because black gonna just improve the position of the rooks and then push the pawns and win the game. So not this way. However, interesting would be if Hikaru goes for queen on c4 after rook on d8, okay? Because this queen now attacks the rook. Also, mating ideas are still on the board, and also queen on e6 is possible. So a lot of ideas, dangerous ideas here. And what black would have to find is rook on d5, sacrificing this rook for the time, you know, needed with the advancing the pawns. One tempo is needed, and this is just, you know, temporary sacrifice. Crazy stuff. Magnus Carlsen probably would not find it with less than 1 minute on the clock, but after e takes on d5, f3, this is a very serious mating threat. So rook on f2 and then g3, and white doesn't have much choice, have to give back the rook. And after knight takes on f3, getting at least these two pawns for this rook, play something like maybe rook on g4, as the queen can attack on e4. So first lock the queen, maybe d4 with the idea of bringing the queen to the defense, and after queen on g3, king e3, rook f4, queen f1. It's still unclear how to continue the game. However, black can just move the rook to f7 and then try to maybe continue the move with the passed pawn. So black should be better here, but it's still a lot to play. So that was, you know, the best idea for black in this position. However, Magnus goes for g3. checkmating threat is on the board, and Hikaru actually panicked in this moment. We have the, you know, recording on the camera, like he just told, like, okay, he just lost the game, he missed everything. There is a checkmate on h2 and some following continuation. However, he play a knight on f3, we had a g2, and there is no really great continuation after rook on e1. There is nothing here. If trying to, you know, create some another queen promo to the queen, the problem is rook on g1 and queen has to take, otherwise this look more logical. However, this is losing because of the mating net. Okay, king on e7 and now bishop b4, king e6, queen h6, king f7 and now queen h7, king f6, e5 now, and as you see, this is already this is just checkmate. Okay, so this is not the way. So Magnus Carlsen try queen on f3. However, the problem is he should stay with the queen on this diagonal and control it. It's still very difficult, you know, to play that, but that was his only chance. But he takes the knight on f3, and here Hikaru just goes for checkmates again. So even without this knight, there is a checkmate. A bishop and the queen can deliver. So we had queen on e5, king on d8, queen on f6 with check, king on e8, and now the commentators in studio try to find some mating ideas with queen on e6, bishop on f6, and they were right. However, Hikaru found the most obvious and the strongest move in the position, just bishop on b4, and the simplest move in the position. So of course we have a mating idea on e7, so c5, just making some escaping spots for the king, but it's not enough, because after bishop on c5, king on d7, queen on f7, Magnus Carlsen resigned the game. And he resigned because if he move, for example, on the eighth rank, then he gonna not only gonna lose the rook, but also he gonna get checkmated, and he cannot do anything about that. That's just a checkmate. And if king on c6, it doesn't matter, it's also checkmate, because queen d5, and now the king is in the front of the pawn, so cannot hide. A4 now attacking the king. If the king takes the pawn, then the rook joined the party, so that's gonna be much easier. But also other moves doesn't really matter. Checkmate is coming on b4. Even king on a5, this doesn't work, because bishop can go even on b6. That would be the most spectacular, because just checkmate in the front of the pawn. So this is why after queen on f7, Magnus Carlsen resigned the game. And I would like to show you the semifinals results of day two. So here we go. Hikaru Nakamura, as you see, won that game. Then we had the three draws. So Hikaru won the second match, and Magnus Carlsen won the first match. So there is 1-1. And today they're gonna play the third decisive match, so we're gonna see who gonna be in the final. And in the second semifinals, Daniil Dubov won against Ding Liren. I show you yesterday the game, so here is the link if you are interested. In the right top corner, there is the bubble with the link, and very nice game. Very short game, only 20 moves. Daniil Dubov won against Ding Liren. Then he won again, and finally, these are the semi-finals. So as you see, Hikaru and Magnus have to still play, and Daniil Dubov is already in the finals. And the finals gonna be played in June, 1st to 3rd June. So that's all for today. And if you like this video, press a like. If for some reason you don't like it, press unlike. Drop the comment. I'm interested what I can improve. What games would you like me to cover? And if you don't want to miss any other games, press subscribe. Smash the bell button. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next one.